I think all the time in terms of theater situations of all of the components. I mean, it's after all, it's and the situation with the history of the decor, given that the early years of Merce and John's work was so much supported by, the enthusiasm about it came so much from the visual artists that were around him. They weren't very well known. I mean, you know, Andy Warhol or Bob Rauschenberg, or I mean, there were just more people around at the bar drinking together and telling good stories and coming up with good ideas. I mean, it could have been some other part of the theater aspect. It might have been lighting designers having a party or something like that. All of those components are a fundamental part of a theater situation, or dance, or opera, or whatever the hell you want to call it, or even movie scenes. I mean, there's all those other people. The thing about the decor is that a good number of the people who did the design things for the stage or the costumes, things of that sort, they were sort of young in their career, beginning in their careers. And of course, there are at least two that are so spectacular that it's hard to, I don't even think it's Bob Rauschenberg on early on and Jasper later on, who continued their work with the company, not just a single gig here and there. The one example I would use that really is monumental is Robert Rauschenberg's first combine, which was the decor that Merce asked Bob to do for Minutia. And the two of them sort of shifted some ideas back and forth to have things right on the stage, not just a scrim or something like that. And so Bob did his first combine, was making this interesting thing for Minutia where the dancers could go in and out of it, and it was fairly much stable on that situation. They got so good that by the time story was put together, there was no decor until halfway through the day that the performance was to begin, and Rauschenberg would pull together whatever he could find. And it was one spectacular thing after another. I mean, that's a living decor development, costume development, which runs amazingly well in parallel with the evolution of the events and the music and the way the music worked for the events. We're talking about people who are really skilled at what they do and were able to get right up near the last minute before you were supposed to lift off, as it were. And there were so few disasters and failures in those. These people were incredible, partly because they worked together well. Not that they were all friends, it didn't make any difference, but they had their theater sense. It's showtime or whatever. I'm using that old standard stuff, right? But that's that center of magnetic energy, if you will, about the creativity, made it possible for the decor to be designed weeks and months in advance, or right on, practically right on the spot. And it was all good. It all worked. So that's partly why I brought up the decor thing, is because the energy and the way the things interacted were really in parallel and sometimes overlapped with the sound, with what the music people did. It's a very interesting world.
Where does chance come in for you? Chance procedures?
Well, in terms of the way I make music, I'm not, chance happens. That's a nicer way to put it, chance happens. But in making my music, except when I'm composing, I don't work the same way John Cage worked, though he worked in many different ways over the years, so we all do. because I was a performer, performing his work and other people's work too, my skills with responding to the chance circumstances were very good, because, I mean, John had it all set up. So he set it out, what one could do and what one couldn't do. He defined the boundaries in various ways. And because we had worked together for so many years, even before I was with the Merce Cunningham Dance Company, performed together before, I understood who he was and what he was doing.
Who was he? Who was John Cage? And what was he doing?
Always moving on from what he did before. Well, I mean, he'd finish a project of some sort, like the sonatas and interludes for prepared piano. He obviously spent many months, part of some years, you know, what he was going to do, and that's what he did.
How did you meet him? Cage, how did you meet Cage?
Well, first was not very significant. In the mid-1950s, there was a conference at the University of Illinois, composer's thing, and he was one of the people there, and I was in Michigan at the time, and I would go to those conferences. Students would interchange from University of Michigan, University of Indiana, University of Illinois, you know, that big central. And he was there, and quite controversial. Some of the, you know, he was still the faculty, you know, how did that creep get in here? Whatever it was, you know. But that was the first meeting, but that wasn't the first significant thing, which was that in 1960, before the first Once Festival, Robert Ashley and John and myself and several others who were working together at Ann Arbor, we knew that Cage and Tudor were somewhere in the vicinity. We got in touch with them. We had $250 for each, and they came and did a recital and some other things that were sensational. And John and I worked together immediately, and David Tudor and I immediately, because I was assisting them technically. And because of my theater experience, we were able to get things set up, and we just worked together right away. Now, I connected with John's music before I connected with John's persona much earlier, when that first LP recording came out of the Sonatas and Interludes.
Did you like him?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's fun. He's fun. Well, at the early stage, it was all giggles. I mean, I don't mean to be frivolous about that, but his accessibility, his marvelous humor, his ability to adapt to the differences of things, and when something preposterous came up, how it got much less so, or even more so, in a lightened and spectacular way. He was always a kind of performer, you know, in a way. When he was with other people, then when he was off doing his work, which might be just on a table near someplace else, where, you know, out of the way, he's like working. He was working on his music, or writing letters to support Merce, or whatever it was. He was constantly busy until he got the mushroom thing going in his life, and then he had much more solitude of going out and interacting with the mushrooms.
A change from people. It was a change from people to deal with nature, maybe.
Could be. I mean, one has limits of how much you want to do the one thing. I mean, how you don't eat the same cereal every morning, or if you eat any cereal at all. So he continually diversified his life, which started out incredibly diversified. Well, I don't need to go into that history, but very flexible, very adaptable.
I should say so. What about David Tudor?
The mystery. I know David very well. I mean, I knew him very well. From 1950 and 1960 on, I actually met him earlier, but that's a different story. But when we were working together, again, from 1960 onward, he was still predominantly a pianist. He had been working with the amplified sounds for cartridge music with John, and that he caught that like a bug. Tudor caught that like a bug. Amplified small sounds, and that was, I think, an infection in a way for Tudor. When he had been playing, you know, everybody's piano music and that sort of stuff, but he got interested in a new direction, which was how he could make his own sounds with all of this little junky stuff, if you will. Now, that's not the first time Tudor was in that way of thinking about building his own sonorities. Tudor was an organist in the early part of his life, a very high quality, extremely good organist. That was his origins. He got into studying and performing piano later. He was an organist. And organists have all those choices to make about sound mixtures and all the rest of it, okay? So it was built into Tudor very early, but that was like a mushroom of its own. Mushrooms, you know, they grow for miles, the roots go, and then they come up at some surprising time in some surprising place. And that's, interestingly, an aspect of Tudor's self-development as a transition from an organist through a pianist to playing bandoneon to becoming a composer, whatever. Tudor had a lot of trouble with the idea of thinking of himself as a composer. We talked about it a lot. See, I began really working constantly with him about 1965, and he still hadn't really done something that he wanted to call his own composition at that time. He was still trying this and trying that. And Rainforest was probably the first of them. I mean, he was working with these things, and Merce asked him, would he do the music for Rainforest? Which, of course, is what happened. And of course, it was glorious. I mean, how could you? Then I remember him saying, I guess I'll have to put my name on that as a composer. He was ambivalent about labels and things that nailed things down, you know, in his creative work.
Were you in Buffalo in 1968 mm-hmm. for that performance of Walk Around Time mm-hmm. and Rainforest?
Mm-hmm. All those premieres, yes.
Tell me about
I performed every one of those.
Tell me about that.
That was an amazing time. There was a lot of snow. It was March, I think, February, March. We had a residency, which was a double residency, both at SUNY Buffalo and at the State University College or whatever. They changed the names every few years, right? And actually, the interesting thing was that it wasn't the big university, it was the smaller one that had the best performance areas. And that's where the premieres were done. That's often written up incorrectly in the history books, by the way. It was at the State College or whatever. They had a much better auditorium, good stage and the like. And that was a busy time. Possible because we were in residence, the whole company. That's all we were doing for 4 weeks, finishing up the details of the Duchamp thing, Duchamp, Jasper Johns thing with David Behrman's music, and putting together of Rainforest, which was largely, David and I were just going on with our work. I was helping him, he was helping me. We just kept going, and pretty soon it was curtain time and on it came. But the putting together of two premieres of two major works in one, I think within a couple of weeks or 1 week or something, that is somewhat formidable. And it turns out they were two of the dozen perhaps greatest works of Merce as far as I'm concerned. I mean, you know, they were monumental. They were monumental.
What to you makes a work one of the greatest? You say one of the greatest works.
Well, I'm just talking from my perspective.
And what is it that makes a one stand out to you as great?
The elements that are strongest for me are choreography, what the dancers do, and the way it interconnects with the decor. I'm gonna put them in that order with some slight arbitrariness, because I mean, after all, this is dance, right? the choreography and the vastly complex things that Merce could do, and the music. I mean, they all fit with it, but the choreography was the center of it for me. Most of what I've learned about time and space and evolution of things musically has been more strongly influenced by what Merce did than anybody else. Somebody asked me once, who was the most influential composer in your life? I mean, don't give me that, right? I said, I thought about it a bit, you know, I don't like doing that. You don't like to put a single thing, lots of things are. And then I realized, Merce Cunningham. The way my own thinking about my own musical work evolved and was nourished, more than influenced, nourished by how Merce dealt with time, space, interconnections, that sort of thing. It was his amazing stuff.
I came to think pretty early on in watching him that the reason he didn't choreograph to music any longer is because he himself was so musical.
Yes.
That it would be like listening to the radio and playing a DVD or a CD at the same time, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that the external rhythms were imposing on his own intrinsic.
Yeah, and he also, because he could play the piano. He was perfectly reasonable. I mean, he knew all kinds of music. He was a good visual artist. He made sketches. I mean, he did everything. He just decided, I suspect, somewhere in his life that what he wanted to do mostly was to run around the stage.
Would you like to tell us what dances some of the dances you did compose for Merce, the scores?
Oh, yeah.
And maybe a little bit about them in any order.
Yeah. There were, I think, three or four specific ones, putting aside the events, which were really collaborative composing, performing, that could have been, well, usually they were John and David and me, or David Behrman, the two Davids. But the first one was for Place, for Merce's Place, and the music I had been working on independently for David Tudor, having to do with his bandoneon. That's where we had started, and Merce heard about it. He said, "Yeah, I will do that. I wanted to." He didn't ask what this was going to be about. But he wanted to do that, and this is before I was working with the company. Though I mean, we all knew each other, and it would have been 1965 that Tudor and I were working on the Mesa, the piece for the bandoneon with all my electronics, and Merce was working on Place. You didn't need music to make a piece. Choreography, and he got in touch with me somewhere early 1966, I think. Phone rang. It was Merce, and wanted to commission. He wanted that piece to be for his next work. And I sent him. I said, "What am I going to ask him about the next work?" I didn't have to know anything, but of course, you know, you make the connection and. I had met Merce before. I mean, we knew each other, but he just told me how long it would probably be. Same thing, 20 minutes or so. And I remember I asked him how many dancers there were. Already I was thinking about how the thing would be on the... And he told me many years later, he was very impressed. I was the only person who would ask him how many dancers there would be. Well, because I'm already interested in speculating about the choreography. So we had these kind of interactions all the time. Later, I don't know if I got the order of the compositions right, but there was that Merce asked me to do for him. There was a TV rerun for which I did my telepos where the dancers wore these accelerometer belts and all of that sort of thing. Some things blur because they were so connected with special things on the outside. Loops was a solo thing that Merce did, and I had him wired up I mean, you couldn't see all the wiring, it's not like that, so that I had his heart rate and his breathing and that sort of thing, which then made musical signals. And the loops thing was very special because we got to work so closely together. And you know what I should do is, I have a, that was never recorded, we were so busy doing it. This was done at the, first it was done at the Museum of Modern Art with one of those big map paintings of Jaspers in the background. And, okay, it was so marvelous. But I did, when we were rehearsing that afternoon, it was somewhere around 1970, something, the early 70s, I think, I'm right on that. When we were rehearsing, I had a recorder on, and I have a recording of us just talking as we're rehearsing, and Merce breathing and all of the things, we're discussing the details. It's quite beautiful.
The dances that stay with me are the ones that have a unity of impression, where the three elements come together in some way that really works.
Yeah, that always rings a certain bell in my mind, too. I have that strange perspective, however, of having been not just involved in seeing it, I mean, whether it was my work or maybe it wasn't something that I had music in, so I could really watch the whole thing as somebody in the audience. Though I was often in the audience, I was in the pit looking up, right? Okay, I mean, it's a strange perspective that I'm in. But of I don't have favorites, though there are monuments, oh, that's an awful heavy word, but there are monuments that are just incredible. And some of course, because most of my time was in the earlier part of the history, the first 20, 30 years at the most, there are those incredible things like in its very special lyrical way, Land Rover, of course, that sort of thing. But then there are those early pieces like Suite for Five and things like that. And I mentioned the Night Wandering. You know, these are the smaller ones that are so. How are you going to step aside from Land Rover or the monumental things with the Duchamp decor?
Walk around time.
Those are so incredible. That in recent times, the past say 20 years, there's things like Ocean, and I mean, which I was not involved with, but you know, you saw most of them when I was in California. I'd go up to Zellerbach, and I mean, you know, speechless. I grabbed Ocean. There were others too. There's that some of the late things that he did with the video projections that were mixed up in with the dance. I mean, this stuff is epic. You just can't. And the problem for those late ones is that I wasn't in the same process with them. That's not a problem, but I mean, problem for my assessing what they were and how they went together. What I saw was the end results, which were, you know, staggering. It's like the late operas of Verdi or something like that. I mean, it just, he got increasingly magnificent.
Symphonic.
Well, yeah, okay, yeah. And his older, I mean, some composers, some painters, some get increasingly gigantic in their accomplishments towards the end of their life. Others fade away, I mean, you know, one way or the other. E.M. Forster, for example, the author, had this brilliant beginning and then sort of faded away in his work. Merce was like, let's say, all the time. Beethoven was like that. I don't want to drop heavy names, but you know what I mean. There are some that just keep getting younger all the time.
One of the last things I talked to Merce about was Beethoven.
Oh, my goodness.
Because yeah. I asked him the great thing about Merce having lived so long and created all these works is that it's rare that you are lucky enough to live in the same time frame with a choreographer who makes so much work, and you can regard it as a single body of work.
Yeah.
the way you can over a long arc.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I was very, I said, how is it that, like Beethoven, composing in his late life when he could no longer hear, you are composing when you can no longer really move? And he said it was habit of mind.
Well, I would, yes, I would, more than habit. But the habit was the foundation, and his habits were so vast. I mean, there are some folks keep cranking out the same old thing over and over again because it's a habit. Habit of imagination is what I would, that's all in the mind. But for Merce, clearly habit of the imagination, habits of the imagination. Late Beethoven, the same thing. He got crazier and crazier. And it, the magnificence just kept going. That's very nice. Habit of the mind, he said.
Habit of mind.
Of mind. Yeah.
What was he like, Merce, to you, as a person or as a performer?
Well, there's two different parts. I mean, we were good friends all the way through. I don't think we ever had a clash or bumped in at all. Of course, we didn't share the same performance space, after all. How could we? Well, sometimes we did, but we were, I would have to say we were very good friends in all the way through. And that's easier for the musicians to be than for the dancers. Because the physical, you know, physical space is very complex when you're actors or in a thing or dancers or whatever you will. I didn't have that situation to interfere with my relationship with Merce. We were good friends all the time, and he trusted me right from the outset, even before he didn't know me that well. He asked me to do this piece, right? That's called trust, or the sticking your neck out, or whatever, taking risk. Actually, Merce was not a stupid risk taker. He evaluated best he could, but what he was a trusting person when he connected with other people that he was working with. It was trust more than risk evaluation, I think, on his part, which probably got him into some trouble, got the company into trouble and in those really, really difficult times like the World Tour in 64 and other times. I mean, you can get into situations where eventually people run away because they got to defend them, their own selves, you know. But Merce was a trusting adventurer. I was probably, in the history of the Cunningham Company, except maybe for John Cage, I was probably the only composer, musician, that maybe spent as much time watching the dance rehearsals, independent of anything else. I couldn't get away from that stuff. I was constantly on the floor in the studio, Westbeth or 498 Third Avenue, all those things, sitting in the corner watching what was going on in the rehearsals. They were so interesting, fixing this, adjusting that, and Merce adjusting his ideas according to the characters of each of the individual people. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, he was working in the early years with Viola Farber and Carolyn Brown and Remy Charlotte and people like that, and he paid attention to who they were. And he would, some particular idea, and then that he would show, and then they would do it. And then the individuality of each of them, he let that grow. This was not ballet where everybody does the same thing in parallel. He was always interacting in his mind with what those people did. I named the earlier ones as the years went on and other dancers came in. The same situation would come up where he attended to the resources the same way I was. I didn't know what to do. I was just watching this. The process was amazing. What I think back on very often now is separate in a way from all of the artistic things that happened. I don't have to talk about the glorious things that happen artistically, but how each of us as individuals bumped into each other, had conflicts, one thing or another, but the devotion that we all had, including ones that couldn't, the dancers who couldn't stand it and quit the company, the devotion, nonetheless, to the momentum of Merce's exploration all through his life carried us through that stuff. I mean, there were times when dancer so-and-so had enough, or they wanted to go off on their own, do their own work, which is a very interesting aspect, too, because I would say this is statistically, I'm making this up. The Cunningham Dance Company had far less turnover of performers in the way of dancers and musicians and the like than almost any other dance company in the 20th century history. It also was the wellspring for the spinning off in the choreographic world and the theater world of people who went on from the Cunningham Dance Company and did major stuff here and there on their own. It was, those things came like that out of Martha Graham or out of the 1930s, Jacob's Pillow era, all of that sort of thing. But the people that came out of Merce's company and went off on their own, unbent, undamaged, and did all that other marvelous stuff. It was he was a wellspring for so many other people in their creative work.